Yet the Spirit came to rest on them also, and they prophesied in the camp.
Weep and wail over your impending miseries.
And as I reflected on that event, I saw a little bit of a connection with the first reading we had about Moses. Everyone. Welcome to all of you wherever you are on the journey of life. We gather together to give praise and thanksgiving as we worship, recalling our baptism, the commitment we've all made to live our lives in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Grace, mercy, peace from God our Father through the risen Savior be with you always. The living Word of God comes to us in surprising ways. We pray that we might be open and attentive to respond to God's Word with generous hearts. And so we take a moment to pray for that openness of generous hearts. Lord, the outpouring of your Spirit knows no bounds. Lord, have mercy. Lord, you anoint us to lavish your justice on all the oppressed. Christ, have mercy. Lord, you empower us to bring your love to the suffering and to the needy. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us. Have mercy on our world. Free us of all sin, and bring us to life everlasting. Amen. And we pray for a moment in the silence of our hearts. Pour out your Spirit, O God, over all the world. to inspire every heart with knowledge and love of you. Grant that we who confess Jesus as Lord may shun whatever is contrary to this faith and give witness to your love that has saved us in Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
A proclamation from the book of Numbers. The Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to Moses. Taking some of the spirit that was on Moses, the Lord bestowed it on the 70 elders. And as the spirit came to rest on them, they prophesied. Now, two men, one named Eldad and the other Medad, were not in the gathering, but had left in the camp. They too had been on the list, but had not gone out up to the tent. Yet the Spirit came to rest on them also, and they prophesied in the camp. So when a young man quickly told Moses, "Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp," Joshua, son of Nun, who from his youth had been Moses' aide, said, "Moses, my Lord, stop them." But Moses answered him, "Are you jealous for my sake? Would that all the people of the Lord were prophets. Would that the Lord might bestow his spirit on them all." The word of the Lord. Thank you.
A proclamation from the letter of St. James. Come now, you rich. Weep and wail over your impending miseries. Your wealth has rotted away. Your clothes have become moth-eaten. Your gold and silver have corroded. And that corrosion will be a testimony against you. It will devour your flesh like fire. You have stored up treasures for the last days. Behold, the wages you withheld from the workers who harvested your fields are crying aloud. And the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord of hosts. You have lived on earth in luxury and pleasure. You have fattened your hearts for the days of slaughter. You have condemned. You have murdered the righteous one. He offers you no resistance. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
With
a proclamation of good news according to Mark. And may the Lord be in our minds, on our lips, and in our hearts. At that time, John said to Jesus, "Teacher, we saw someone driving out demons in your name. And we tried to prevent him because he does not follow us." Jesus replied, "Do not prevent him. There is no one who performs a mighty deed in my name who can at the same time speak ill of me. For whoever is not against us is for us. Anyone who gives you a cup of water to drink because you belong to Christ, amen, I say to you, surely will not lose his reward.
Whoever causes one of these little ones who believes in me to sin, it would be better for him if a great millstone were put around his neck and he were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life maimed than with two hands to go into Gehenna, into the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life crippled than with two feet to be thrown into Gehenna. And if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. Better for you to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than with two eyes to be thrown into Gehenna, where the worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. The Gospel of the Lord. This has been quite a week, hasn't it? The first time in his entire life that Pope Francis came to the United States. Many significant events happened this week, and I'm wondering how many of you saw something of the visit of Pope Francis throughout the week. Something? Okay, most of us saw some part of it. He really covered a lot of territory, visited with a lot of people in all levels of society. I'd like you to try to think for a moment. There is something in particular that struck you about Pope Francis with his visit this week. Think for a moment if there was some particular message he gave or some particular action he did that maybe touched you. And then, if you're feeling brave, we'd like to hear about it. I have the microphone. I'll come to you. Let's take a moment to think if there is something in particular that struck you about Pope Francis and his visit, and that you would be willing to tell the rest of us about. Who would like to start? Where?
He was the first pope to speak in front of a joint session of Congress ever, and Catholic Church outdates America by quite a lot, so that's pretty insane that he's the first.
That was an amazing event. I heard that other popes were invited, but none of the others accepted the invitation, but this one did. And he was invited by John Boehner, the Speaker of the House. And maybe you know John Boehner is a Catholic, and Vice President Joe Biden is a Catholic. So it was kind of fascinating in watching that to see the Pope in the middle and these two guys right behind him, also both Catholics. That was a very significant historic event in his message to Congress. Another thought about the visit of Pope Francis. Something else you'd like to highlight?
This morning I saw him speak in front of prisoners in Philadelphia, and I thought it was quite a contrast from speaking in front of the political elite to those that need repentance, as we all do, and that was his message, and that was something that keeps us all equal and why we come here.
He makes quite a concerted effort to reach out to all stratas of society, from the high and the mighty to what society might see as the lowliest and the poor. Very impressive. Very much embodies the lifestyle of Jesus. I think that's what gives him such appeal. It's rather easy to see Christ in the actions of Pope Francis, and not just the things he says, but the things that he does. Anyone else a thought about Pope Francis you'd like to share? Yes.
I was impressed one time. I saw they were covering as he was driving through, and he stopped his motorcade to bless people along the way, and one in particular was a handicapped child, but he gave no regard to how important everybody thought he was, and he had all the security around him. That didn't matter. He was there for the people, and he just stopped, opened the door before the car even stopped, stepped out, and just blessed these people. That was very impactful for me.
And he drives his security people crazy.
So John Boehner was on a talk show this morning, and he talked about the meeting and how impactful it was. But they were separating and going their own way, and they were waiting for the elevator. And so he put his arm on, the Pope grabbed John Boehner, and they said a couple of words. But in parting, he pulled him real close, put his arm around him, and said, "Pray for me." And John Boehner just, I mean, he was taken back. Why should I pray for him? Well, he did, but it was asking others to pray for him.
Very moving. Yes. Thank you. Someone else? That's a perfect segue to the other point I wanted to make. John Boehner also made headlines this week. It was fascinating to watch him sitting behind the Pope. Never so often, I found it a little distracting, you know. He pulled out this handkerchief from his suit, and that's all that you saw, and it went back in his pocket. And then he did it again, and went back. I thought, well, the poor guy must have a cold. His nose is dripping. Well, found out later, he was so moved by different aspects of the Pope's talk, and I think many of us know how emotional he is. He was actually wiping away the tears. He was so moved by some of the things that Pope Francis said. And you know, many of the rather tough things we heard in the second reading, the letter of James, some very pointed words from James, but Pope Francis made many of the same points, but certainly not with the harshness that James expressed in that reading. Pope Francis, very diplomatic in trying to inspire people to also be concerned for the poor, to realize that things in this world are passing, that there are eternal values. And I think Pope Francis does that in such a diplomatic way that it's much easier then to absorb that than maybe listening to our fiery patron, who was called the Son of Thunder, because he and his brother, they wanted to call down fire on those that weren't open to them. So Pope Francis has a little different manner than our patron of James. Well, and what I wanted to say about John Boehner is that it was amazing that the day after the visit of the Pope at Congress, he resigned. And as I reflected on that event, I saw a little bit of a connection with the first reading we had about Moses. We didn't hear the part that led up to that. Moses was worn out. Moses had the people grumbling at him, complaining about him. Here he was, the great liberator, leading the people out of Egypt, leading them through the desert to the promised land, helping them to connect more with God through the Ten Commandments. And they were griping. They were grumbling. They were complaining. Why? They were sick of the manna, the bread that God was providing. They said, "We want meat." Well, I could identify with them. I can't have a meal without meat. Apparently, they didn't know about vegans or vegetarians in the desert. And they were grumbling. They said, "We were better off in Egypt. Maybe we were slaves, but at least we had meat." And Moses was so fed up, he prayed to God for death. He prayed to God that he would be removed from that very tough situation. Well, that's an incident with Moses reminded me a little bit of John Boehner. Resigning the next day. Now, Moses couldn't resign. How can you resign from being the liberator of a people? But John Boehner decided the time was right for him to resign in order to further the common good. I think because we heard so often that reference to the common good in the words of Pope Francis, and John Boehner now, after several years of attempting to bring together grumbling and murmuring factions, realized he had done what he could, time to pass on the baton to someone else. So I see a little bit of a connection there between Moses and John Boehner in admitting that they've done what they can and it's time for somebody else. And so Moses had these 70 people come together, and they were going to be reinforcements. God sent down his spirit on these 70 people in order to help Moses with his leadership. Two guys weren't present for some reason. Eldad and Medad. Anybody here named Eldad or Medad? Be great names for twins. If you ever have twins, of course, that'd probably be two boys. Eldad and Medad. They weren't there when the Spirit came down, and yet they still were doing the same work as the ones who were there. And the leadership said, Moses, should we get rid of these guys? They didn't follow the rules. And Moses said, no. Would that all of God's people were prophets. Would that all of God's people would absorb the word of God and bring it to bear on our human condition. And you know, that includes all of us here. All of us here have been baptized. All of us here share in that role of prophecy, of bringing the word of God to bear on our human condition. And I say that because when each one of us was baptized, we were chrismated with oil, chrism, on our forehead. And this is the prayer that was prayed over each one of us. As Christ was anointed priest, prophet, and king, so may you live always as a member of his body unto everlasting life. We all have been anointed to be prophets, to share in bringing the word of God to bear on our human condition. And so Jesus had the same issue. Should we cast away these that weren't technically in our group? Jesus said, no, they're doing my work. Even though maybe they didn't follow all the rules, they were still doing my work of bringing the word of God to bear on the human condition. So one of the messages I take from those two readings this weekend is how inclusive our God is. Nobody's to be left out. Everyone's to be included, even those that don't follow all the rules exactly. They still are sons and daughters of God. And I think that's part of the powerful message Pope Francis brings us. No one is to be excluded. No one. Wasn't it amazing how he took those reporters by surprise some months ago on the plane when they put a question to him about gay people? He said, well, if they're sincerely seeking the Lord and trying to do God's will in their life, you remember what he said? Who am I to judge? Now, if the Pope isn't the one to judge, certainly you and I aren't the ones to judge. And I think that's consistent with the gospel message. No one is to be excluded from the family of God. No one is to be denied Holy Communion. Nobody's to be denied coming to participate in our Catholic faith. And on many different levels, Pope Francis is attempting to refashion the rules and regulations of our church so that more people actually experience a warm welcome. Like maybe you heard recently in the news, Pope Francis has loosened up the many hoops people have to jump through in order to get an annulment, in order to say that their marriage is null and void, a value that we hold that marriage is a lifelong commitment. But the reality is it doesn't always work for everyone. And so Pope Francis also wants the divorced to feel welcome, the divorced to be a part of the faith community. It's when you experience a trauma like that that you are most in need of receiving the Lord in the Eucharist, of experiencing the presence of God through one another. And so I think we're going to continue to see more and more ways in which Pope Francis is refashioning our church, making it true to the vision of Jesus. Would that all God's people were prophets. If they're not against us, they're for us. And you and I participate then in implementing that grand vision, welcoming all, excluding no one, judging no one. And so in this Mass this evening, let's pray that we might be up to the task. Let's pray that we might come here often for the nourishment we need
in order to bring God's word to bear on our day-to-day lives, because we all participate in that prophet ministry of Jesus, bringing the word of God to bear on our human condition. So we come for the strength we need to do that, and we give thanks that we are called to do that. And in a special way this evening, we give thanks that we have such a wonderful, humble, courageous, and powerful leader in the person of Pope Francis, and pray that he has a long life so he can implement that grand vision, which really is the grand vision of Jesus Christ in the gospel. On page 10 is our profession of faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body,
we direct our minds and our hearts to God, asking for peace, healing, and compassion for all who are in need.
Our prayer will be, hear us, O Lord. For those who struggle with addiction and who are unable to see a way out, please light their path. O God, we pray.
Hear us, Lord.
For those scared to profess their faith in public and truly grow close to God, that they may summon the courage to surrender themselves to their faith. O God, we pray.
Hear us, Lord.
For those who allow material things to hinder their relationships with God, O God, we pray.
Hear us, Lord.
For those without a proper education and those who struggle to learn, O God, we pray.
Hear us, Lord.
For Syrian refugees and all refugees around the world, that they find safety and assistance. For world leaders that deal fairly and compassionately with those seeking refuge in their countries. O God, we pray.
Hear us, Lord.
For all who are signed in our Book of Life, for those mourning someone dear, and especially Joyce Divine, for whom this Eucharist is offered. O God, we pray.
Hear us, Lord. You call us to faithful service, O God of generous love. Your loving kindness knows no bounds. Hear our prayer for those in need, for we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated. You might be aware that we are most fortunate in our area that our neighboring churches all work together. It's called the Cooperating Churches of Sussex. And that grouping of the various Protestant churches with us runs this, the Sussex Outreach Center, the Sussex Food Pantry, and they have three full-time employees that help people with other needs as well. A social worker, help in finding jobs, help with other bills they can't pay. When their electricity is going to be shut off, they can't make the rent and they're going to be evicted. Three full-time employees. And I'm telling you all of this because this week we learned that the food donations are abundant to the food pantry, but the money has been down. So this month, they don't have enough money to pay the three employees that we have to run the Sussex Outreach Program. So all of the churches in our area are taking up a second collection
this weekend to help give a little boost to our outreach program. So after this first collection is completed, we're going to send the baskets around one more time, and whatever comes in the second round, we are going to give to the Sussex Outreach Services to help them get through this very difficult time of their lack of money.
Presentation song, Grateful, Psalm 32.
pray, friends, that these are gifts. The many gifts of our church may all be acceptable to God, our loving Father. Amen. God of mercy, look with favor upon our offering, and in this Eucharist, open to us the source from which all blessings flow. We make this prayer through Jesus Christ, our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty, our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, Lord of heaven and earth. For by your word you created the world. You govern all things in harmony. You gave us the same word made flesh as our mediator, and he has spoken your words to us, called us to follow him. He is the way that leads to you. He is the truth that sets us free. He is the life that fills us with gladness. Through your Son, you gather women and men into one family, redeemed by the blood of the cross, sealed with the gift of the Spirit. Therefore, now and for ages unending, with all the angels and the saints, we sing your glory. Indeed, holy, and to be glorified, O God, you who love the human race, who always walk with us on the journey of life. Blessed indeed is your Son present in our midst when we are gathered by his love, and when, as once he did for the disciples, so now for us, he opens the scriptures, he breaks the bread. Therefore, Father, we ask you to send forth your Holy Spirit to sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, that they may become for us the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, on the night of the Last Supper, he took bread and said the blessing. He broke the bread and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the cup. Again, he gave you thanks and gave the cup to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for all, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this to remember me."
The mystery.
Therefore, Holy Father, as we celebrate the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Savior, whom you led through his passion and death on the cross to the glory of the resurrection, and whom you have seated at your right hand, we proclaim the work of your love until he returns. We offer you the bread of life, the cup of blessing. Look with favor on the offering of your church, in which we show forth the paschal sacrifice of Christ entrusted to us. Grant that by the power of your Spirit of love, we may be counted now and until the day of eternity among the members of your Son, in whose body and blood we have communion. By our partaking in this mystery, give us life through your Spirit. Grant that we may be conformed to the image of your Son. Confirm us in the bond of communion with Francis, our Pope, Jerome, our Bishop, and all who serve your people. Grant that all the faithful of the Church, looking into the signs of the times by the light of faith, may constantly devote themselves to the service of the gospel. Keep us attentive to the needs of all, that sharing their grief and pain, their joy and hope, we may faithfully bring them the good news and go forward with them along the way of your kingdom. Remember our loved ones who have fallen asleep in the peace of Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone can know. Admit them to rejoice in the light of your face, and in the resurrection, give them the fullness of life. Grant also to us, when our earthly pilgrimage is complete, that we may come to an eternal dwelling place and live with you forever. There, in communion with Mary and Joseph, the apostles, the martyrs, St. James, and all the saints, we shall praise and exalt you through Jesus Christ, your Son.
Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
With the words of Jesus, we pray for the daily bread our world needs.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, now and forever. Amen.
And may the peace of the Lord Jesus be with you always. We share Christ's peace with those around us. Peace. Behold the Lamb of God, broken and poured out for us all. Blessed are we called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
May the body and blood of Christ bring us to life everlasting.
I invite forward the ministers of communion for the homebound. We're very grateful you can bring the Eucharist to someone who can't be here, and so we send you with our prayers. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Gracious God, let this holy mystery restore us in mind and body, that we who proclaim the death of Christ and are joined to his suffering may become co-heirs with him in glory, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen. So as if the second collection was eventful enough for you, next week we are going to have what's called a reverse collection. Speaking of CCOS, as Father was talking about earlier, we like to have a time where we give back to our community. So what we will have is, after the collection, there will be the baskets will be redistributed to the rows. Instead of putting something in, you will take something out of that collection. No, not money. You're not that fortunate. But what will be in those baskets are little pieces of paper that give suggestions on how to give back to the CCOS food pantry, especially. So it would be food items and different needs that the food pantry needs. So next week, look forward to that. Take a sheet and really just continue to serve like you've always served. Continue to give like you've always given with the reverse collection.
The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in peace to love and to serve the Lord.